There's been nobody tougher than China.
Greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, located not far from the Redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Mumbledy-Mum has left me alone for a moment, so I'm not going to mention his name. Buddha is in my room. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. And this is a bit of a news show episode, and my apologies for the delay in getting it out, as I'm sure all of you know, it's been a hell of a week on the public sphere, and I've had a bunch of shit happen around here. Not all bad, however, so there is that. I'll start with the personal stuff first. I have managed to find another job. I have some misgivings about the job because, it's one of those that is a little too good to be true. I mean, it's a real company, it's not like it's a scam or anything like that. However, it is, they're paying me stupid amounts of money. For this job. And my concern is that they're just trying to get people in and they have no intention of keeping them for any length of time. So I could be out of there really quick, or I could, manage to stay there for a while. I'm hoping I can stay there for a while, because it's going to pay a shitload of money, like I said. Not only on the hour, but also they're putting in 12-hour days, 7 days a week, which is going to be rough. But I can do that. That's easier than when I was working at Rich's and doing 16, 17 hours a day, 7 days a week. It also means that I'm not going to be able to have any co-hosts on any of the episodes because my schedule is just not going to permit that to happen. And I also point out that the job is going to be third shift, so that is another little issue. But hopefully I can keep the job. Hopefully, things slow down just enough in a bit that I'm not working 7 days a week. We'll see how it goes. And I'll put out episodes as often as I can. I can't promise the content of them, as you can imagine, but I will do it. I unfortunately have I was going to try to cut this episode last night, but I had a case of food poisoning, so I couldn't do it. And unfortunately, with both dealing with all the stuff related to getting that job and all the shit that's going on in the world, I couldn't write up a really good script for this episode because every time I started on it, got partway through with it, something big would happen and I'd have to throw everything out. Or I'd have to go for an interview or something like that. So that's where we are. I am going to be spending this weekend taking care of plumbing as best I can. because with 12-hour days, 7 days a week, it's not, I'm not going to have time for I don't know how long to do it. So I've got to try and get it done this weekend. We'll see how it goes. And I am not giving my notice to Stanley. Since they're laying us off for 2 weeks, I will work that job for 2 weeks because I start that job on the day the layoff begins at Stanley. And if after 2 weeks I don't like that job, I can just go right back to Stanley. If I do like that job, then I can call Stanley and say, I'm sorry, I have to quit. So we'll see how it goes. All right. Now, on the national news, they're totally, international front. Holy shit. There is so much to cover, so much to say, and I'm going to do some injustice to all of it, and I apologize for that. First thing I want everybody to know is you have seen posts by people on Facebook saying, oh, if you need to go camping in another state that's friendly to camping, let me know and I'll help you. Some of those people are well-meaning. Some of them are fucking Christian assholes who are trying to trap women seeking a necessary medical procedure. Unless you know that person personally, I would not trust that. If you you don't want to go to jail. The other thing is, in the show notes for this episode and every episode that I put up show notes, there are all kinds of links to abortion rights groups, women's health groups, and things like that. Contact them before you go. If you're somebody who has to leave a state to get an abortion, contact those organizations first before you do anything. Because they will tell you how to keep safe. They will tell you the things you need to do so you don't have to worry about getting prosecuted. They can also help you if you don't know anyone out of state who can help you. And if you're going to look at donating to abortion rights groups and organizations, try to find one that's in a red state, not a blue state, to donate to. Here's why. Because blue state organizations will always be able to get help from their state government, as long, of course, as the government there is democratically controlled. Red state organizations won't. They will need the money most because they are going to have to be getting people out of the state. They're going to have to be dealing with lawyers constantly. There are already instances of women who have things like ectopic pregnancies that have to be aborted because there's no way it can be viable. Going to a hospital in an anti-abortion state and the doctors spend 9 hours on the phone with lawyers making sure that they can perform the procedure. In many cases, they're having to wait until the woman is at the verge of death before performing the procedure to ensure that they meet the criteria laid out in these new laws. And sooner or later, women in that situation are not going to survive. And then, you know, and some of them may already have died because they've had to wait. And the doctor guessed wrong as to the woman's health, and she has not survived. So that is something to keep in mind. Also, these laws impact people other than women or those capable of giving birth. Certain medications are going to be harder to get for anyone, because those medications can be used to induce a chemical abortion. So the states are naturally going to make it harder for you to get those medications because they're going to be afraid of people using those medications to, you know, sell them on the black market or whatever. So, but yes, check the show notes. I got all kinds of links, and I'm adding more all the time to you know, help deal with this crisis. And it's only going to get worse until we overthrow the Supreme Court at the polls. And something I want to point, I just have to say, there are a lot of people who are out there going, oh, I'm so glad that the January 6th committee has managed to take attention off abortion and put it on the coup attempt, because this is, you know, this is such a threat to our democracy. And it's women saying that too. It's not, you know, very left-leaning women who are saying that. I've seen it mostly. But that's the wrong idea. Because one couldn't have happened without the other. The situations that allowed us to get to a point where we could have a president of the United States trying to sue the government are the same ones that led to having a Supreme Court that has no respect for the law or human dignity. And there's been a number of discussion about various, say, other rulings that the Supreme Court has made that were all horrific. There is one in particular that is not being talked about that should be well known. And I need to point out that this was a 7-2, not 6-3 decision. So, one of the more rational members of the court voted irrationally. This is the Marietta Memorial Hospital versus DeVita. It says that insurance companies do not have to pay for medical procedures that would extend a patient's life. Wherein, basically, it says if you've got late-stage renal disease, they don't have to pay for dialysis. That's where it's at right now. It will be expanded to cover fucking anything and everything you can think about. Somebody's fussing at me. As if you needed further proof that this country desperately needs universal health care. The Supreme Court gave it to you. And again, if you're in a non-U.S. country and you have universal health care, if your government decides they want to get universal health care, I will run guns to your country. Because seriously, this is a threat to people's lives. People are going to die. They're going to suffer and die. I mean, they figured out something like 300,000 Americans died during COVID because they didn't not have adequate medical care. Not because they had the reason is because they had underlying health conditions that when they contracted COVID killed them, and had the ability to access health care prior to contracting COVID, those underlying conditions could have been treated and they could have survived. So, and I think the total number of Americans who die each year because they lack access to health insurance, medical care that they can afford without COVID, is in the hundreds of thousands. So those are pretty sobering thoughts. And there is this idea that some people have when they talk about the fact that, you know, boomers have a lot more wealth than any other generation. And when those boomers die, that wealth will then trickle down to the younger generations. That's not how it works in America, because the bulk of an individual's wealth evaporates in their final months of life, because they have to spend all of it to try and keep themselves alive. The other, of course, is Supreme Court allowing that fucknugget to prey on the football field and basically demand that students participate. It's a horrible goddamn decision, and it is paving the way for theocracy. And while I hope that the Church of Satan gets involved and manages to, you know, get lawsuits going, I don't think they're going to have any impact. And that's not a slam on the Church of Satan. Lawsuits like they would file need to be filed. But I can tell you exactly what's going to happen. The Supreme Court is going to rule that, oh, well, we're a Christian nation. They are going to do that. Because that's their attitude, and I believe some of them have even said as much, that, you know, this is a Christian nation. You know, it wasn't the Jewish members of the Supreme Court who voted against abortion, it was all the Catholics. So, you know, it'll still be 6-3, even with the notorious KBJ on the Supreme Court, because, you know, she's non-denominational Christian, but she's not going to be enough to sway the vote. Now, maybe she could make arguments that none of the other rational justices have been able to make that will convince enough of the fuckheads on the other side to change their views. I don't believe so. And here's why. Because in his concurring statement, Chief Justice Roberts said that while he thought the ruling went a bit far, getting rid of Roe versus Wade, and he would have been much happier if they had done it differently, he still voted for it. Motherfucker had objections, but, well, still concurred, because he's a fuckhead. And that I've seen a bunch of articles of saying how John Roberts lost control of his court. Fuck them. Fuck them. Dude knew, you know, okay, if he bailed on the Roe v. Wade decision and said, no, fuck you, I'm, you guys are too far, this is the wrong interpretation, I don't like Roe, but this is the wrong way to go about dealing with the issue of abortion, so I'm voting against it, he might have shifted somebody else. Might not have. Might have been a 5-4 decision. But it would show that, yes, he does disagree with the decision, and he does understand the implications of the decision. He does not. He truly does not. If he's being honest, then says he doesn't think it's going to lead to all kinds of shit that he supposedly disagrees with. You know, like throwing out gay marriage, throwing out birth control. And Thomas is kidding himself if he thinks that they won't that Loving versus Virginia won't get thrown out if the Republicans have their way. It will. It will. They will roll this country back to 1840s or the 1820s and wipe out two centuries of progress as soon as they can. And the latest ruling to come out that is horrific is the one that basically strips the EPA of their authority. And they've already done it with other government agencies, saying that, well, you know, there's problems with the government oversight, blah, blah, blah. So they've effectively gutted every government administration in charge of keeping us safe from corrupt corporations. And yes, those corrupt those government agencies don't do nearly enough, but as we're all going to find out in the very, very near future, things would be a whole shitload worse without them. Now, as bleak as all this sounds, and I could actually make it bleaker, there are possibilities for hope. The Roe decision might be enough to get overwhelming numbers of people to vote Democratic in the midterms, which is important. Ideally, what would happen is if they vote in the midterms and the Democratic candidates sweep the offices up for election in the House and the Senate, we will have a huge, overwhelming majority of Democrats in both houses. And I'm not, there is 438 seats in the House. I'm not going to pretend that Democrats will win all of them, and I'm not going to hazard how many they might win. But if they get over, 60-70%, that's going to be awesome. That'll be awesome. There are also 21 Republicans up for election in the Senate, or re-election in the Senate. If we don't lose a single Democratic seat in the Senate, and if we're going to dream, we're going to dream big, and we manage to pick up all 21 of the Republican seats in the Senate, that gives us a total of 71 senators. And a whole lot of shit becomes possible for Biden to do then. I mean, because we don't have to fucking worry about Manchin and Sinema. And I know people are saying, well, we just need two more Democrats in the Senate and Manchin and Sinema become irrelevant. No, they don't. We need more than that, because we need at least 60, because that's how many it takes to overrule the filibuster. And so long as... Well, actually, we need 62 to make Manchin and Sinema irrelevant. And so long as Manchin and Sinema are in the Senate, they are not going to do anything about the filibuster. So we need to swamp them by a good 12 senators, and ideally we'll get 21 Democratic senators added to the Senate. But not only can we kill the filibuster when you do that, and Biden can get just about anything he wants ran through Congress, there are other things that could be done. Whether or not Biden will do them, I don't know. There's a lot of talk about expanding the Supreme Court to 13 justices. The reason is each justice sits supervises at least one circuit court. There are 13 circuit courts in the U.S., so if we have 13 Supreme Court justices, then nobody's having to do double duty. And I don't know exactly how they work it. They may work it so that, one of them handles two for 6 months out of the year, and then somebody else handles two for 6 months out of the year. I don't know how they do it. But let's not stop there. Because you know, we expand if Biden can expand the court to 13 justices, that's good, but that's still not as good of an insurance policy as we really need, because Thomas is the oldest justice presently on the court. He's 72, so he could easily be on there for another 10 years, and you know, there's, you know, the youngest, of course, is Amy Covid Barrett. Maybe the notorious KBJ is younger than Covid, but not by much, if she is, like a year or two. So, you know, and who the fuck knows who's going to be in the White House 10 years from now? And, you know, I mean, I guarantee you, if a Republican wins the White House in 2024, fucking oldest right-wing judges on the court are all going to retire. Give that guy younger picks, and those people will be just as fascist as, or even more fascist than the justices they're replacing. So that's bad. So what we need to do, and this will ensure not only that the current crop of fascist justices are rendered irrelevant, it'll make it hard, nay, impossible, for a situation like this to arise again. And this isn't my idea. I heard it from somebody, and he had a slightly different take on it than what I'm going to give you. And I can't remember his name, or I would give him the credit for it. But his idea is simple. Don't simply expand the Supreme Court to 13 justices. Expand it to 169 justices. I know what you're thinking. What the fuck? Why would you have 169 justices? Here's why. And other countries do something similar to this, by the way. So, as I said, each justice, if you have 13 of them, each one of them would sit atop one of the circuit courts and supervise them. Well, do it this way. Have a 13-court Supreme Court over each circuit court. So if you were appealing all the way up to the Supreme Court, and, you know, when you went through the Fifth Circuit, you would get their 13 justices. Now, you could request that your case be heard en banc, meaning, you know, all 169 justices, but not necessarily. Would you do that? You know, would that happen often? And even when it did happen, it wouldn't happen, you know, it would be up to the justices, the full court, to agree to take it or not. Now, why is this, and wait, before I get into the effectiveness, let me get into the mechanism of how this would work, so it wouldn't be total chaos, and it would have some changes to it. The first change that you would make is that every justice from this point on could serve no more than 24 years on the bench. That gets rid of, you know, the people who stay far too long. It also means that there's less of a scramble to get a to find somebody to put on the court if somebody dies unexpectedly, because they're not going to be hanging out on the court for so long. And it also deals with the issue that we have now, where you know, somebody runs a decision through a circuit court, knowing that that circuit court will be favorable to them, and then, you know, and the justice who sits on top of that circuit court will push for that, you know, for them to rule on that ruling. People, they do it all the time now. There's a, I think it's the Fifth Circuit. There's a circuit in Texas that all the tech companies like to use because they know they'll get favorable rulings out of the court. And even if it goes to the Supreme Court, because of the circuit system, they're more likely to get a favorable ruling. Well, you know, with the system I'm describing with 169 justices, you will have things, you know, you'll have somebody say, oh, well, I'm going to run this up to this circuit court because I know that these justices on top of that court are more favorable to my, you know, my choices. That's fine and all, unless, of course, somebody files for an en banc ruling. Well, then suddenly you've got 169 justices on top, you know, who are going to be looking at the issue, but potentially. And that gets rid of, you know, that lessens the chance that an individual circuit court could impact a ruling. You know, what makes it that far and what doesn't, because the, you know, various courts can say, you're done, no more appeals for you, and you're fucked before you ever get to the Supreme Court. So there's that. And I'm not suggesting that Biden appoint a whole shitload of justices all at once. No. What we would do, and I mean, this would make it maybe more, well, I'm not going to say more. Because in theory, we wouldn't need Republicans but for this with an overwhelming majority in Congress. But, you know, it might get Republican voters to, you know, be like, okay, we really don't care about this. It's not so important. But the new courts would be rolled out staggered every 2 years. And, you know, and I don't know how they break, like I said, I don't know how they break down who sits over what court. But, say, Sotomayor sits over the Second Circuit, all right, when the new Supreme, the 13 Justice Panel is created for the Second Circuit, Sotomayor would be one of those justices on that court, and her slot on the main court would be filled by somebody else. That way, they would have somebody on that court who was experienced in the way things work, and, you know, they would carry over a sense of tradition. But that wouldn't, you know, and they don't pick the justices, so you don't have to worry that, well, John Roberts is now over this court, so that's going to make it Republican-leaning or whatever. It's like, no, it's going to be all determined by who's the president as to who's on that court. And by doing that, you've got it, you know, set up so that the court will have naturally have a different character, because each, regardless of whether or not the White House remains in control, you know, or the White House and Congress remains in control of Democrats or not, this is going to take a couple of administrations to fully fill out the Supreme Court. And, you know, President A might have the same pool of justices that President B does, but President B is going to pick a different one from that pool than President A will. In some cases. I mean, when you're dealing with Republicans, they've got a list of fascists, and it doesn't really matter which one they, you know, they're going to pick all the fascists. I would also require that there be, I would say, you know, you'd have to have qualifications to be a Supreme Court justice. Right now, they could literally make anybody who wanted to be a Supreme Court justice, a justice now, of course, that's unlikely to happen. But as we have seen, Trump had no problem appointing people to courts that the American Bar Association has said were unqualified for the job. So, and to avoid, let's avoid the politicization argument and not hinge the required qualifications on whether or not the American Bar Association thinks someone is qualified, put it on their, you know, required of their experience. So, you know, they have to have spent 15 years as a practicing attorney and or a judge. So they would have, you know, they would have to have been a judge. You know, they may have only been a judge for a year, but they had spent, you know, 13 years as a trial attorney. That would get some levels of qualification, and you wouldn't have to worry about people accusing them, oh, well, they're going to let this liberal organization say who's qualified and who's not. No, it'll be based on things like education and experience. So, you know, they have to have a law degree, they have to be a judge, and they have to have been a trial attorney. That, or at least a lawyer of some kind, that, you know, and, you know, their total years in practice, either as the lawyer or a judge, has to add up to 15 years. That ensures that we've got a better chance of having qualified people on the bench. And by spacing them out every two, you know, the creation of a new court every 2 years, you have the opportunity to fill, you know, when the new court is created, it has 2 years, it gains 2 years of experience before there's people working on the next court. And also, again, it gives you a stagger, you know that 24 years, roughly, after the first new Supreme Court is formed, you're going to have to start picking replacements. And there's going to be situations. The other thing is, if, you know, there's a cap on how long a justice can serve, some of the justices who are on there now are going to say, well, you know what, since I know that nobody can serve on here longer than 24 years after me, I'm going to go ahead and step down, because then we can, you know, we know exactly when they will be leaving the bench at the absolute latest. So it won't, and if you're appointing people who are in their 50s to the bench, odds are most of them will still live to be, you know, will live to be in their 70s. So they're not generally, you know, the number of them that would die before they step down would be rather small. So again, it gives it a nice thing, and nobody after, once the whole courts are filled, nobody is going to be, you know, nominating a huge chunk of justices in a single term for the court as a whole. Because who knows, if we do this, who knows when somebody like Amy Covid would step down. She would probably say, well, everybody else on this court has to stay for 20, can only stay 24 years. I'm going to stay until I die. Well, okay, so that's a long-held seat on that court. But as soon as she's gone, then it's a 24-year thing. And it gives some variation into the amount of time that people serve on a term. And you would start, that would help that, you know, the system immensely. And with having such a large court, the odds of us getting, you know, one political faction so dominant that and unwilling to obey the law that it would would be pretty slim. Now, of course, I don't think this is actually going to happen. Best we can hope for is that Biden expands the Supreme Court to 13 justices. But, you know, like I said, if you're going to dream, dream big, baby, because we presently have a Supreme Court that has no respect for the rule of law. Or anything, really. So it is going to be a nightmare for us as long as they're in power. And even if we add four more justices to the court, I don't see it as being effective enough. Because there's always going to be somebody who can't, you know, says, well, they're wrong, they're, you know, the Nazis are right about this thing here, and goes for that. Remember that stupid fucking cake decision? You know, the guy who, well, I don't want to sell cake to gay people. Well, that's fucking discrimination. But the Supreme Court said no, because it was a deeply held religious belief. He was allowed to be that kind of asshole. That's fucking wrong. And that was well before the court got shifted as far as it did, and it had, you know, was, I think it was Breyer who, you know, voted with the majority, and probably some others. So that's bad. And if we had 169 justices on the court, the odds of them getting enough to have an 85-84 ruling on something as heinous as that cake case are a lot lower. And not that you needed more examples of Supreme Court idiocy, but I've got another one for you. And again, I'm just scratching the surface. I saw a Twitter thread, but unfortunately it didn't have links to the things it was talking about, so I don't know how accurate it was, but it listed the shitty decisions that the Supreme Court had done this term. There were 25 of them. So, and of course, you know, they've got it EPA, they've got it federal agencies, the ability of oversight, they've destroyed Roe versus Wade, it goes on and on and on, but you get the idea. Now, of course, but this is, Clarence Thomas gave a speech, and of course, you know, it had to be done. But Thomas thinks that COVID vaccines are made with aborted fetuses. So yes, he's just as fucking stupid as his wife. That's really all I have to say about that. Although, you notice, we've heard nothing about who leaked the draft document. Wonder why? Because they didn't want to expose Jenny Thomas? Yeah, I'm sure that's what it was. They didn't want to expose Jenny Thomas as being the one who leaked it, because she's almost certainly the one who did. Than any of the lefties, I can tell you that. Now we'll wrap this up with a little bit of happier news. I'm sure all of you heard that Trump attacked his Secret Service driver on January 6th, when Trump found out that they were not going to the Capitol, but were going back to the White House. There, of course, are, well, the GOP's calling it all hearsay. Well, guess what? As you probably heard on various other podcasts, it's not hearsay. But video has surfaced. taken from outside the vehicle, which was not the beast. It was, it's the big giant SUV that they use for the president when they're doing something somewhat unexpected, or they're doing, or they're, well, it's not just unexpected. At times when the president is in a motorcade, they have, you know, the presidential limo, and then they have SUVs that are identical looking, and sometimes they will put the president in the SUV rather than the presidential limo, especially if they think there's a high risk to the president. And other times, for certain trips, they will only, you know, they won't have the limo, they'll have the SUV for whatever reason. But anyways, there's video from outside the SUV that pretty clearly seems to show Trump grabbing the driver's arm. Now, they're not underway, but it definitely seems to be what, you know, that he's grabbing the driver's arm. And supposedly, they have all kinds of video equipment inside the vehicles that the president travels in so they can record all the incidents. I don't know this for a fact, but it sounds plausible to me, because that way, if something goes wrong during an assassination attempt, they can hopefully later on figure out what went wrong and why. Also, if, you know, there are things that they need to have official records of that the president says, so that would be an easy way to do it. But we'll just have to see, and I will have links to the video in the show notes. And if I can find it, there's a great political cartoon that shows Trump trying to strangle the driver of the vehicle, but his hands are too small to do it. Okay, so I've got to get out of here. My advice is get involved in politics, get involved in activism right now. We need it. We have to do a big shift in Congress come this election. Have to get overwhelming numbers of Democrats elected. And it also needs to be done at the state and local level, because in a lot of states there are Republicans running for office who say they're going to enact policies that will prevent Democrats from ever being elected again. So it's got to be, you know, a broad sweep across all levels of government that the Democrats, or rational independents, third party candidates win. So, and get involved. I know from experience that poll watchers are desperately needed. So, call your local Democratic Party and ask them about volunteering as a poll watcher. You'll get paid, you'll get paid training, and, you know, you'll be performing an important service, making sure that the laws are followed correctly. And you won't be just at one polling station all day. You'll be traveling, at least here, because we don't have enough poll workers. They travel from polling place, you know, they have a couple of different polling places they go to. So they go to one, stay for a little while, go to another, stay for a little while, go to the third, stay for a little while, and then cycle back through them. I don't know exactly how it works, but that I do know that's what they do. All right, so I will talk to you again as soon as I can.
That's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes. It's also on Stitcher, and most of the episodes are on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter at TParkAtheist, and it's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist. You can email me at trailerparkatheist@gmail.com. Show notes can be found at tparkatheist.blogspot.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to donate to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show's notes page. You can also support the show on Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker.
With the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.